Thank you for having me. This is joint work with Simon, postdoc at UCH, and joint also the data collection joint with UNICEF Malawi. And this is about why people follow traditions. So you may think, I don't know, what's your favorite tradition here at Berkeley? I saw that there is this naked run, for instance. This, you can think of this. Why do people do that? Of course, you can think of other traditions. I will use interchangeably social norms. So why do people do those things? So of course, there's a large literature on this, partly claiming that people do conform to norms out of intrinsic motivation. So you might think that out of culture, values, religion, people just want to engage in those behaviors. There's alternatively explanations that people do this based on extrinsic motivations. Maybe they do this based out of incentives, or they fear being sanctioned if they don't follow the behavior, the tradition, and so on. Or maybe they do this based on beliefs about what others do or expect them to do. So there's lots of evidence on those different things, and of course they may be combined. So in this paper we're going to look at a particular combination of those drivers, which is the hypothesis that individuals follow traditions at least partly because they want to signal that they are pro-social, that they can be trusted, that they are good citizens. Of course, this signaling mechanism has been considered theoretically, but it hasn't been empirically tested. Why do we think that's relevant? Because there's a bunch of traditions or social norms that in the end lead to either inefficient outcomes. You may think of corruption in a setting, you know, where everyone is corrupt, or you may think that everyone expects you to be corrupt, then you may also engage in corruption out of this. Or inequality, if you think also that discrimination can emerge out of that. Or even there are some traditions, often called by UNICEF, for instance, as harmful traditional practices that end up destroying children's human capital. And there you can think of child marriage, female genital cutting, sexual initiation rituals. And if partly people follow those traditions, based out of signaling motivations, then it would be interesting to know if that's the case, because you might think that, you know, as an economist, you may try to change the separating equilibrium by introducing alternative signals. So that's what we're going to try to do in this paper. It's also in Malawi, so nice continuity from the previous presentation. We start with a nationally representative survey where we ask people in an open question, you know, what would you do to build a great public image or a great reputation? And then people can answer as many things as they want. And of course, they say things like, you know, you just have to be nice to others, or, you know, don't be antisocial, work hard. But, you know, 40% of them say follow traditions. So that begs the question of, you know, does this also apply to traditions that have these harmful consequences, in particular destroy children's human capital? The other thing is, you know, there's these different drivers of public image. We want to know whether you could potentially create substitution across those different drivers. So if people follow traditions in partly to build public image, but they also are nice to others to build public image, perhaps if we, you know, make it easier to help others, perhaps they follow traditions to a lesser extent. So that's what we're going to look at in the context of Malawi. So the intuition for, you know, why this actually may be the case is, I won't bore you with details, but you can build a simple model where, you know, there it's hard to induce cooperation in the short run, because people, you know, prisoner's dilemma, people can always deviate and rip you off by pretending they're going to cooperate, but not doing it. But there are payoffs that from cooperating in the long run. So there are some people that are patient enough that will actually want to enforce long-run cooperation. It's just hard to do it. In some societies, like you may think Malawi is one of these cases, there are, you know, no courts that would enforce contracts and so on. So it really depends on trust and on being able to figure out who is pro-social and who is not. But it's not easy to observe that. So you may think that whoever values cooperation in the long term to a greater extent may be willing to pay for costly signals such that they can separate themselves from the others. And one of the signals could be following one of these traditions. It's not like people like harming their daughters, for instance, but that may actually help them build their reputation as a good citizen in the village, for instance. And so you may think that in the baseline equilibrium, you could have a situation where, you know, with no signaling, you cannot distinguish blues from red dots. But, you know, if there is this costly signal available such that cooperative individuals are willing to pay for it, but it's not worth it for the non-cooperative ones to do it. If they're against from cooperation, you should be able to see that. under some conditions, then it would potentially have a separating equilibrium based on following this tradition. Now, if you introduce a new signal in this model, what could happen is that the prior separating equilibrium could break down for several potential reasons, actually. Maybe what happens is that there is a new signaling equilibrium where people indeed adopt this other signal in order to separate themselves. So maybe it becomes even more extreme, and then people adopt this new signal. There's a new separating equilibrium. Alternatively, what could happen is that the new signal actually breaks down the separation, and then you have everyone pulling either no one else signals or actually everyone babbles. So they take up the new signal, and then in any case, you don't know. This is based on beliefs of what would happen out of equilibrium and so on, but in the end, you don't know anymore who is cooperative and who is not. So that generates different predictions, for instance, about predictability of who is prosocial or not, based on who is taking different signals and so on. We're going to actually look at that in the data. So to be concrete, because so far it's very abstract, what we're going to look at is whether, you know, supporting child marriage in Malawi is perceived actually as a signal of prosociality, where child marriage is prevalent. We're going to randomize the availability of different signals and then see who takes them up and, you know, the profile of those. Does it change predictability of who's prosocial where we introduce these new signals? And what these new signals do to the value of child marriage as a signal of prosociality? And finally, we want to see if those new signals actually change people's attitudes towards those practices. Do they no longer support child marriage and initiation rituals because they have these new signals available? That's what we'll do. So, if you don't know where Malawi is, small country in southeastern Africa, this is what it looks like in a typical village, at least when it's rainy season. So, you know, typical village where we work in has 116 houses, so fairly small. And the houses are kind of not so close to each other, so, you know, each one would have their own plots raising maize and would interact with one another kind of frequently, but, you know, there's scope for figuring out that you don't interact with everyone all the time, so maybe you don't know who is cooperative often and so on, and so the signals might be valuable. Child marriage is pretty high, kind of everywhere in the country. So you see, you know, the lowest, this is prevalence in the past. Okay, so people who self-report that they were married before the age of 18, which is the legal age. Of course, it's much higher in some parts of the country. Sexual initiation rituals are much higher in the south. So these are rituals that when boys and girls reach puberty, families would, you know, prepare them for adulthood. So this involves, their initiation involves lots of things, kind of education to be an adult, knowing how to hunt for boys, for girls, house chores, and so on. But, you know, in some parts in the south, there's also sexual component, which may be from range from FGM, from cutting, to less extreme forms, but some of them involve sexual components, which would be, you know, either hiring a sex worker to kind of clean the dust, as they would say, or encouraging them to find matches and then getting initiated at pretty young ages. So this can be from 8 to 14. So in this context, we want to understand, you know, what happens when we introduce new signals. If this can potentially be a signal, as I said, for prosociality, and what happens when we introduce new signals. You may think this is actually hard to answer the questions that I posed. Because to figure out whether it's a signal or not, you need to understand whether people consider those that support child marriage, for instance, to be more prosocial. But whether you support a norm or not is not randomly assigned, right? So if you see this correlation, it doesn't mean it's causal. And if you want to introduce new signals, or to see if new signals actually change the value of child marriage as a signal, these signals are not available, you know, by random assignment. So what we need to do is to randomize both the availability of signals and also the adoption of signals such that we can figure out what people think of those that adopt alternative signals. So we're going to do this by combining an RCT with a survey experiment. So it's pretty simple, I think. The RCT is a 2x2 design. In half the villages, we'll make available public donation boxes whereby people can donate 2 kilos of maize that will be redistributed to the poorest in the village. All right? And then in half the villages, we're going to have bracelets available, sometimes in combination with the boxes, sometimes not. So, you know, this is where the two are available. So if you donate 2 kilos of maize, you get a red rubber bracelet that's very visible, and people will figure out that you have donated because now you have the bracelet. In a quarter of villages, you only have the boxes. So this is already, you know, public donations. So it should be visible, but not as much as when you have the bracelet. In other villages, you just have the bracelets, and then you can buy them for the price equivalent of 2 kilos of maize. But it's very different. Nothing to do with donations. The money will not be redistributed. And then in one quarter, you have none of those. All right? The hypothesis is that, you know, whenever you have this, this, or this in particular, then you have different signals of prosociality. And then, in particular, in this combination is the strongest alternative signal. We want to see what the availability of this does to child marriage and perceptions. On top of this, we want to see what people think of those who adopt the signal. So we show them, it's a survey experiment. We show people either this version, which is John marrying off his daughter, 14 years old. Okay, so this is harmful John. And there is the there's two versions of this that each person is going to see. Either this version first, and then later the same version wearing a bracelet. Or this version, which is John not marrying the daughter, they're having dinner together, and so on. And there is a version also of him wearing a bracelet. In some villages, the bracelet won't mean anything, so that's control. But in some villages, it will actually stand for donations, and so that's what we want to see. Whether perceptions of, you know, John will change when he's wearing a bracelet or not, in particular villages where bracelets are meant to represent donations. All right, so I'll skip details, I think, but, you know. This story that we show is a particularly extreme representation of the phenomenon. Most of the child marriage is below 18, but not below 15. So we show this version, which is pretty extreme, to see what people think of him. And then we ask them to judge John with respect to several dimensions of prosociality: altruism, reciprocity, trustworthiness. And then we build a summary measure to see, compare how people think of different versions of John. When it comes to attitudes, then we'll ask people about, you know, what is the right age for a woman to get married. And then if it's below 18, we'll say, this person supports child marriage. And sexual initiation rights, we say, should they be continued or not? Okay, explicitly mentioning the sexual component. If the person says yes, then the person favors these rituals. Okay, everything that we'll do, and we pre-register like this, is going to be heterogeneous according to what is the local norm. And then we look at prevalence. So, you know, in one third of the villages or a bit more, there is no child marriage at all below 15. So in these villages, you wouldn't expect that if someone supports child marriage, this should lead to a good public image, right? Whereas in the other two-thirds, there is some prevalence. So you may imagine that the higher the prevalence is, then the better should be someone's public image if it's actually a signal of prosociality. So we're going to interact everything with the prevalence, which we show is not affected by the treatments. All right, so first, just to get started, you know, we ask village chiefs we randomly pick five people in each village, and then we ask the chief to say whether the person supports child marriage and to judge this person based on this altruism, trustworthiness, and these measures of prosociality. So unsurprisingly, perhaps, you know, where child marriage is not prevalent, then you see that this person, that whoever supports child marriage, the chief also considers this person to be not prosocial. So it's kind of a negative compared to those that do not support child marriage. Whereas in high prevalence villages, it's the opposite, and this difference is significant. Of course, support for child marriage is not randomly assigned, so that's why we need the survey experiment, but this already suggested that this potentially is a signal of prosociality. So when we go to the survey experiment, then what happens is exactly the same. So in villages where you can see, you know, John supports child marriage, this was randomly assigned at the household level, as I said, the survey experiment. When it's not interacted, it means in villages where there's zero prevalence. So there, John, who supports child marriage, has a quite negative reputation across all dimensions. And then as support increases, the reputation becomes better and better, eventually flips at the high end of the distribution. So it confirms this idea that it can be, you know, there's signaling value to supporting child marriage when the prevalence is high. Now, what happens when we introduce the new signals? We collect a lot of maize, as you can see. There is some differences across conditions, and there is some imperfect compliance that enumerators sometimes manage to place the boxes in the wrong village, but it's a small percentage. But typically, we collect a lot of maize, over 40 kilos, whether bracelets are available or not, and we sell or distribute a lot of bracelets in combination with donations or not. Now, you can already see some interesting patterns here of whether this can act as an alternative signal. So, you know, people already donate a lot, even outside of the experiment in those villages, because the poor donate, you know, maybe, you know, cross insurance and so on. So even in control villages where the box is not available, about one third of the households donate, we ask in surveys. Now, when we introduce boxes, then this share increases. So boxes indeed lead to higher donations. But most interestingly, the profile of those who donate changes. So in control villages, you can see, for instance, those who donate, they are wealthier. They spend more. per week, and that correlates strongly with donations. In where boxes are available, there is no longer a correlation with weekly spending. So different profiles of people are donating. If you are married below 18, you really don't donate in control villages, but you donate to a much greater extent in where boxes are available, and so on. So you see that the profile changes. You can also see it when you look at the, you ask people to self-rate themselves in what comes to pro-sociality, those dimensions. And then you see that, you know, control is blue. In the, when boxes are made available, this shifts to the left. So people that are less pro-social start donating. This is the profile of those who donate. So actually, people start self-selecting into this alternative signal who would not typically be donating. And then what does it mean in terms of the signaling value of child marriage? First, when we ask the chief to predict who is pro-social, you know, by rating five random people that we pick in each village, and then we compare this to people's self-assessment of pro-sociality, what happens is that in villages where the box becomes available, chiefs become worse in predicting who is pro-social. Remember that different profiles of people start donating, right? And you no longer can guess that because someone is wealthier, for instance, or doesn't support child marriage, or supports child marriage, this person donates or does not donate. So the chief becomes actually worse in knowing who is pro-social in those villages. And this is not because people feel more pro-social, because it doesn't affect at all how people self-report in terms of pro-sociality. So it's consistent with a pooling equilibrium, if you will. You can also see this in other ways. I think I'll just keep this in interest of time. Very quickly, if John is wearing a bracelet, so we go back to the survey experiment, when he wears a bracelet, his reputation improves in general. So it and it improves in where bracelets actually mean donation. So it doesn't improve in every village. Where bracelets mean nothing, then you see basically no change. But where it means donation, that it significantly improves. So that makes sense. And that's interesting what it does with the whether of how people rate the reputation of harmful John across different profiles of villages. So where child marriage is not prevalent at all, if you remember, John that supports child marriage, it has a negative reputation. He doesn't follow the local norms. Now, when he's wearing a bracelet, his reputation significantly improves. So that kind of dampens this negative signal. The opposite happens in villages with high prevalence. So if you remember, in the control condition, if you are in a high prevalence village, you support child marriage, you have a positive reputation. Now, when you're wearing a bracelet, now this becomes negative. So really, this dampens the signaling value of the former signal. And then finally, when it gets to attitudes, which I think is the, you know, less conceptual, more concrete measure of whether this actually changes people's minds, support for child marriage. And remember, in the intervention, we never said anything about child marriage. I mean, it was about donations and bracelets, okay? So I guess this is surprising, unless you're an economist. Support for child marriage significantly decreases, I think by about 20%. Very significant in villages where donations were available. And this is not social desirability, because when we ask about actual child marriage, which, you know, cannot change within the 5 weeks that we leave the boxes and do the survey, this does not react to the availability of boxes. So it seems that it's really attitudes changing. When it comes to sexual initiation, you see the same thing. Mm-hmm. So it decreases by, I think, 20% as well, significant, but not the actual prevalence. This difference is, you see, the norm is changing over time by a lot. So support, either there is social desirability overall, but also it seems that support is changing over time, but still significantly affected by the availability of the new signals. This is really being driven by the households at risk. So I could show you, girls at the, well, it's coming, for instance, from high prevalence villages. So if all the change was coming from low prevalence, it would be really weird, right? So it comes really from the villages where prevalence is high. Then I have to click back. And then, you know, some people get married because they followed traditions, others get married because they were poor. And, you know, this, the effect is coming from those that get married because of tradition, so that also makes sense. I don't have time to give you details here, but something else we randomized is who is the box or bracelet holder. We wanted to understand if it matters or not to engage local elites if you want to change social norms. So in half the villages, whenever we introduced boxes or bracelets, those things were sitting with the village chief. And the other half, we just picked someone randomly from the village to be the box or bracelet holder. And then there's a lot of action there. I'll show just one graph. for norms that the chief controls, it actually makes a lot of difference. So child marriage, the chief has no control over it, according to the chief and according to the villagers. And then no matter who holds the box, if it's the chief or someone else, support decreases. Okay, so the chiefs don't matter. For initiation rituals, villagers say the chiefs are among the most important decision makers. And here it makes a lot of difference. If the chief is holding the box, then support decreases. But actually, if he's not holding the box, then it significantly increases. So it kind of backfires. So if the chief loses control, traditions are a way to exercise control. If the chiefs lose control, potentially may actually see the opposite happen. And so you have to engage elites properly. So just to conclude, I think, I mean, this is novel evidence on a mechanism behind falling tradition and potentially and particularly harmful social norms. I think it could help explain, you know, we're seeing support for these traditions fall a lot worldwide. So FGM, child marriage, this is falling at very fast rates in many, many countries. And it's a bit of a puzzle for UNICEF in particular. Part of the reason might be that due to rapid urbanization and, you know, these societies become less trust intensive, and then there is a lower signaling value to following traditions. So maybe that helps explain it as well. Besides suggesting, you know, cheap and scalable mechanism at least for to design interventions that could speed up the process of abandoning these harmful practices. Thank you. I'll stop here. Say again, the poorer people?
The poorer people in the village are...
This I don't have, actually. I had the those who donate. Is that it? Is it this one that you want to see?
no, maybe go back to sorry.
Yeah, I don't have much.
Okay. Well, I'm not sure, but... So, I guess the question is, how do you think about income effects here? So, if you think about the donations... And those are the people that are kind of driving the support for child marriage.
Oh, I see what you mean. I can look at that. I actually didn't. It could be if these things are super correlated. So, like, these guys don't donate to start with, and they are also supporting this. So, I'll look. But the thing is, you know, we did this all very short in time. So, we left the boxes, and then we came back 5 weeks later. So it's not like redistribution had already taken place. So they were waiting for us to come back. So it's not the case that the poor already had the extra maize and they were behaving differently. Maybe they could be doing this based on expectations. So let me check.
Yeah, so I still have. And expectations of others, right? So people might think, you know, I'm not poor, but if a poor person, you know, is not able to eat and so they marry off their daughter to get an income, like to get some income, then I can kind of understand that. But now that we have this system, I'm like less supportive of them.
Yeah. Let me look. I mean, what we can see is that this is coming particularly from the families with the daughters at risk, let's say. So this is coming from the ones that have the daughters at the right age, and particularly from females and so on. So it could be, we're coming back now, 12 months later, to see actual behavior, if actually they didn't get married or get initiated, so that would say something. But I'll look at whether this is coming from the poor. Yeah.
Forgive me for asking a boring question for an interesting paper. When you compare the donations versus no donations, say the support for child marriage, is that sort of clustered at the village level? I kind of worry about maybe there's a bunch of people owning one village that are kind of doing the same thing. That would be the kind of setting where a 1 percentage point impact would sort of matter if you have some kind of local clustering.
Yeah, so everything clustered at the village level. These are Fisher tests, but then in the tables, I think we do more because then we really interact with the shares to see whether this is coming from the high support or not. And
it was kind of like I was having a hard time thinking of the confidence intervals being so tight.
The sample is huge, so that's something because this was UNICEF wanted a representative survey of Malawi, so we have like 10,000 interviewed across 400 villages. So even with the village clusters, there's still a lot of observations. So maybe that's why.
10,000, still, isn't that p times 1 minus p divided by, anyway, it was.
Because the support is low, you mean?
Yeah. Yeah, it's like, you know, you have a 1 percentage point change in the, anyway, I'm not, as I said, it's a boring question, but that was, that's a sort of worthwhile to kind of make sure. Mm-hmm. Just looking at it, you'd be surprised that it's a p-value of 0.001.
Yeah, yeah. Well, double check. Thank you. Yeah.
What was the incentive for no donation villages to get the bracelet?
For where just bracelets were available?
Yeah, I got it.
No, so they can buy it for the equivalent, the price equivalent of 2 kilos of maize. Why would they do it? I mean, they really like this. So when we were piloting, trying to think of what kind of signal would be appealing, it came up that either these bracelets or hats were something that they really like. And so also to kickstart the treatments, what we do in every village that has either that has bracelets is that we distribute bracelets to 10 people. In the villages where it's bracelets combined with donations, we ask the chief to list the 10 people most likely to help others, and then we already distribute this just to get it started. In the other ones, we randomly distribute them. Yeah.
Yeah, I was wondering how those families actually see child marriage. So is this something that is seen as sort of like securing family outcome and therefore being to the detriment of the child? So it's people do understand that this is maybe not as great for the child, but for the family it's great. And then I was trying to think about that in the context of these donations that were, I think, for child health sort of purposes or something like that.
So no, it was for the poorest in the village.
Oh, just for poor. Okay, then it's just that question.
Yeah. So it's hard. I mean, we ask people why. You know, if you got married before 18, why did you do it? And then, or like, why do you think the right age is below 18? And they often reply something like, you know, it's always been like this. So it's consistent with this idea of long-standing traditions. And also when we ask people like who decided, they often say they decided themselves. So self-reported answers like this are always hard to know if you take them at face value or not. But for instance, very few report that they get married out of poverty. But we do have evidence, including for Malawi. So we have in a different paper looking at rainfall shocks and so on, that actually this affects a lot the extent to which parents sell off their daughters. So it's a bit hard to know from their answers. But if you want to take it at face value, they don't say it's for economic reasons or so on. They often say that they decided and these traditions are there for a long time.